So we're interested in answering a very simple question. Suppose we have a series, this infinite sum going on. Does it converge or does it diverge? Now, when we talk about something converging, what we really mean is it goes to some finite value. When it diverges, that means it doesn't go to some finite value. For example, it heads off to infinity. Now, it can get very tricky because oftentimes we're like, well, we'd like to find the answer, but for most sums, we can't. It's really hard. It's like integration. There's lots of things that we know in theory we could integrate, but we actually don't know how in practice to find antiderivatives. So what do we do? Well, what we can start doing is, hey, let's compare. So instead of trying to answer it with the exact problem we're looking at, we can say, let's make it a comparison of something that we can do, something that we understand, and then we can go and make a decision from there. So our goal for today is to talk about how can we make comparisons between sums to help us answer the question, do we converge or do we diverge? Let's begin. So we'll start very simply with something called the comparison test. And it says what? Well, suppose you have some non-negative things being added up. And for right now, we're going to focus on non-negative. We'll get into things with negative later on. But all right, so we have 0 less than or equal to an, less than or equal to bn. And it says what? Well, suppose the sum an diverges. Great. Then what has to be true? The sum of bn diverges. Well, why? Well, just think about it. If we think about it in terms of the partial sums, we can say, hey, in terms of partial sums, we have the sum from k equals 1 up to capital N of a sub n has to be what? Less than or equal to the sum k equals 1 to capital N of b sub n. And that's just saying that we know that 0 less than or equal to a and less than or equal to bn. That has to be true. So what's happening is if that our a sub n diverges, well, that says our partial sum goes to infinity. And so we say, okay, whatever this sum does, it has to go to something at least as big as infinity. But once you're as big as infinity, you're infinite and you're done. Okay, so that explains that one. But now, okay, what if your sum b sub n, what if that converges? The claim is the sum of a sub n converges. Now, intuitively, we're just saying, oh, if we add up the b sub n, it's finite, and the sum of the a sub n, well, that has to be less than or equal to that, so it also has to be finite. So that's a great intuition. Now, if we want to be slightly more rigorous, and I'm not going to be too much more rigorous, we could say, hey, let's look at the following. We know that we're in the situation now where the sum k equals 1 to n, well, I should say 1 to infinity, of b sub n is equal to something. It's equal to L. Okay, well, that's greater than or equal to our finite sum. Okay, right? Because all the terms are greater than or equal to 0. So if I, you know, if I'm adding, then I stop. The rest of it can only make it bigger, can't make it smaller. Okay, and this, of course, says what? That's the sum k equals 1 to capital N of a sub n. Now, here's the fancy way to see what's going on. That says this partial sum is bounded above. And it's bounded above by whatever the sum b sub n converges to. It's bounded above by L. And the partial sums are monotonic. Well, why? Well, the reason that they're monotonic is to say, hey, you know, take a look. A sub n is greater than or equal to 0. So as I tally, I can only increase. I can't go down. So monotonic says one behavior, and our behavior is going up. So you have monotonic bounded above, therefore it must converge. That was one of the things that we mentioned, the monotone convergence theorem. So that's how we know if the sum B sub n converges, then the sum A sub n converges. But intuitively, it makes sense, right? It says, look, if our sum B sub n is finite, our sum A sub n is at most whatever that finite is. So I can't have an infinite thing that somehow squeezes in below a finite thing. All right. Now, how do we use this? Well, what we do is we look for ways to take our expression for B sub n and to somehow break it down, relate to something simpler. Oftentimes, when we talk about simplifying an expression, what we really mean is taking out things like addition and subtraction. And so, phrased another way, find the essential behavior. What's really going on? And use that to bound, either above or below. Now, you have to kind of make a decision before you think about bounding. Because if you think that the answer is it diverges, you've got to bound it from below. And if you think that the answer is converges, you've got to bound it from above. So bound it from below by something which diverges, or bound it by above by something which converges. Now, if you bound something from above by something which diverges, you've done nothing. If you bound it from below by something which converges, you have done nothing. I mean, this doesn't help you make a decision. So you have to be careful. Make sure you're bounding in a way that's appropriate, and that'll give you information about what's going on. Now, one thing that we're going to reference a lot, and so it's good to have handy at your disposal, is that we have two important types of series. One series is geometric. So if we have something geometric, so k from some starting point to infinity of r to the k, you can even throw in a constant, doesn't matter. Well, this converges if and only if what? Well, what we need is to have r be small. The other one you need to have in your back pocket is if you have the sum k equals, again, some starting point to infinity, and then it's 1 over k to the p power. Now this is a p series. So this is geometric series, this is p series, and so this will converge when? Well, it converges if and only if what's true. Well, hopefully you know this. If not, it's a great time to learn. It converges if and only if p is at least 1. And this is one of the conclusions we got from the integral test. So most of the time when we make comparisons, it's usually to something that looks like this. Either a geometric thing which converges or diverges, or a p-series which converges or diverges. So that's a good thing to be on the lookout for. In general, it's important to understand the relative sizes of things. So, you know, what's bigger than what? Because it's the large things that you need to pay attention to. They're going to be driving behavior. So factorials are large. There's things which are even bigger than factorials. So never think, aha, I have found the biggest thing. No. You can always go bigger. But the important thing is factorials are large. They're bigger than exponentials. And exponentials are large compared to polynomials. And polynomials are large compared to logarithms, which are large compared to constants. See, there's a sort of pecking order. And you want to make sure you understand where things fit in. There's one useful piece of advice. When oftentimes we're doing a comparison test and we're having to make a decision about what to compare to, keep in mind that when there's an expression downstairs in your denominator, larger denominator corresponds with smaller value. So keep track of that. It's important to remember. Now, part of the problem with the comparison test is finding that right function to compare to. Because oftentimes you'll get a lot of what I might call noise. All this extra little bits of flotsam and jotsam floating around. Ugh, hard to keep track of it. So there's a refinement. And the refinement is the limit comparison test. Now between the two, limit comparison is a little bit better, but not in all situations. There are situations where you want to have comparisons, so know both. Well, what does the limit comparison test say? Well, it says, suppose you have two positive sequences. So we're not going to let anything be zero. And now what you want to do is look at the ratio, a sub n divided by b sub n. And now we want to say, well, what happens to that? there's a couple of possibilities. Well, suppose A sub n over B sub n is some number, a positive number, positive finite value. Then the conclusion is, whatever one sum does in terms of converging, diverging, the other sum does. This might sound familiar. It might sound something like what we did when we talked about improper integrals. It's the same philosophy. Now, what's really going on here? Well, what's really going on here is the following. If we know that A sub n over B sub n is getting close to L, then we can say, look, for large n, and when we're talking about things whether converge or diverge, we only care about n way over there, the tail, as we head to infinity. What's happening at the end? That's what we care about. So for large n, what we can say is, look, A sub n over B sub n, it's between L plus a little bit and L minus a little bit. And we can make this little bit, this epsilon, as small as we want. And so we say, oh, great. So A sub n is less than L plus some epsilon B sub n, and it's greater than some L minus epsilon times B sub n. And now we say, hey, let's pull out the comparison test. So if we know, for instance, that A sub n diverges, then some constant times B sub n diverges in the tail, of course. And the tail is where the tale is told, so to speak. The question about converging, diverging, it doesn't matter what the first five terms do, the first million terms, the first 100 billion, quadrillion terms. They're unimportant. It's what happens at the tail. So we say, okay, look, if this diverges A sub n, then what's true? Well, then anything above it has to diverge. So if I take a constant times B sub n, if that diverges, then the B sub n must diverge as well. If A sub n converges, well, a constant times B sub n converges, and therefore B sub n has to converge. So essentially what's happening in the limit comparison test says, oh, if you go far enough down, then you can really make a nice direct comparison between these two values. Don't worry about what far enough means. It's just there is something far enough. That's why we have this limit as n goes to infinity. So it gives us a nice way to say, oh, these two things go together. Now, this is the majority of the limit comparison test, so I want to make sure we emphasize what's going on here. What's going on is we want to keep the fastest growing parts and ignore the rest. That's what you do with limit comparison test. Another way to put it is to say, get rid of anything where you see plus or minus. So if you say, oh, there's a bunch of terms being added together, or a bunch of terms, you know, and there's a subtraction, you how do you get rid of the plus or minus? Well, you only keep the largest terms. Now, you might say, well, how do you know which one's the largest? Well, that comes back to understanding the rate of growth. Okay, if you have exponential versus polynomial, okay, which one wins? If you have a factorial versus an exponential, which one wins? And so you say, okay, if I have a bunch of things being added, only keep the largest part from each part where things are being added. And now you've collapsed everything down. And now you have just sort of a single expression that you can work with. And oftentimes that becomes like a P series or something simple, something geometric, right? So that's how the idea works. By keeping the largest terms, you compress it down to something simple, and now you can work with that. Okay. So that's if our limit is some finite number. Well, what happens if it's not? Well, if A sub n over B sub n goes to zero, how is that possible? Well, if A sub n over B sub n goes to zero, what it's really saying here is that A sub n over B sub n is small. So in particular, A sub n is less than B n for large n. That's the only way that's possible. And so, hey, we know that for large n, A sub n is below B sub n. So if B sub n converges, A sub n converges. unfortunately, we can't go the other way. So notice that here you have, look, both converge or both diverge. No. If it goes to zero, you only have one direction. So if the B sub n converges, A sub n converges. What about the opposite? Well, if A sub n over B sub n goes to infinity, it says, hey, A sub n has to be bigger than B sub n for large n. And now our conclusion says what? Well, if the B sub n diverges, right? So that says that the A sub n also has to diverge as well. All right, so there we go. Limit comparison test. Just remember, get rid of the noise. Focus on the fastest growing terms. Understand that behavior. And then it becomes much simpler to answer our question. Do we converge or do we diverge? And with many, many things, this is best seen by example, which means practice. Do practice. The more you practice, the more you become familiar with how these work. So I think it's safe to say, time to go and do some practice. Hope to see you soon. Bye.